Happy Sabbath, church.
Happy Sabbath.
Is anyone out there? Good morning. Happy Sabbath. There we go. I can see you, but I couldn't hear you. I just want to welcome everyone to church this morning. We're so happy that you've come and joined us, either here in person or also we want to welcome our people who have joined us online. Just thank you so much for being here and welcome to the Lord's house. We'd like to just get started this morning with some prayer and just asking the Lord to be in our presence. Please bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for your love and for your kindness throughout this week and for bringing us into your house this morning to fellowship with one another and to fellowship with you. I ask that you would please be with us as we enter into this service, that you would just send your Holy Spirit to dwell among us, that we could really receive a blessing today and that our hearts and our minds could be open to you and your words and to your guidance in our lives. And each of us comes after a different type of week. Some of us had a really good week, and others had a really hard week. And I just pray that whatever we bring to your altar this morning, that you would just take it from us and that we could just rest peacefully in your presence. We love you, Lord, so much, and we're just so grateful for your many blessings in our lives, and we're just so grateful for your love towards us. In your name, amen. Our first song this morning is going to be Days of Elijah. This is an old but a goodie, and I think everyone here should know it. So I want to hear you guys singing nice and loud.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore.
Song, which is Blessed Be Your Name. So let's go ahead and sing that song together.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where the streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun shines. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes,
no matter if we're at the top of a mountain feeling great or in the deepest, deepest valley, that we can always, and we are always invited to come to God, to lay whatever burden down, and to just come to his altar and to say, we're here, God, speak to us. Let us learn from you. Let us be a part of your presence. So let's go ahead, thinking of those songs. Please stand with us now as we sing a slightly more modern Christian song now, O Come to the Altar.
Are you hurting and broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
You may be seated.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. The scripture reading for today is from 1 Samuel, chapter 3, verses 9 through 11. That's 1 Samuel, chapter 3, verses 9 through 11. And I'll be reading from the New International Version. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. The Lord came and stood there, calling as at other times, "Samuel, Samuel." Then Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears of it tingle." May the Lord bless today's word.
As we continue our worship service, it's time for our Garden of Prayer. Those of you that would like to come to the front and kneel with me and pray, please do that at this time. In prayer, we talk with God, but hopefully we also listen. So may the Lord bless Pastor Benjamin as we listen. Wherever possible, let's reverently kneel before the Lord in prayer. Our kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you today in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We praise you, we thank you for sending Jesus. Jesus can set us right with you. We thank you for the eternal life that you have given to us. May Jesus come soon and we receive our glorified body. As your Holy Spirit shapes the character of Jesus in our lives, Lord, give us a spirit of submission, a spirit of cooperation. May you work in us that which is pleasing to you. Holy Father, we think of our church members who have had tough times this week through the storm, through sickness. Some have been in hospital. You know all our trials and our tribulations, Lord, and we lay them at the feet of Jesus. And we ask for your will to be done, realizing, Lord, that all things will work together for good for those that love you. And we thank you, Lord, that we do love you. And we know that we love you because you first loved us. Fill us with your Holy Spirit today. May this worship service be sweet and acceptable to you. And especially bless our speaker, Pastor Benjamin. Just anoint him, Lord. May we hear you as we listen. May we hear your voice. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
So I was wondering, is anyone ready for a quiz? Now some of you I know, especially students, or some of you are probably gonna be groaning and saying, I'm not missing the quizzes. Others of you might actually like to have a quiz. So anyway, I wanna ask you have a quiz. So are you more of a giver or are you more of a taker? And you know, really, when I think if we were all honest, the reality is most of us from early on, we learn to be consumers. At least here in the United States, it seems that's the case. Because even when you're young, you can go and have an awful lot of stuff. And you know, I just remember when our kids, they seemed like they had more toys than they could possibly ever play with. And that might be the case as well. I know as you go into some thrift stores, it's just loaded with all these toys that hardly even look like they've been used. And yet we end up carrying that on into as adults. And if any of you have a garage, you know what I'm talking about, you know, or a shed or attic or any place like that, we've got too much stuff. Really, the only way that we can be able to go and conquer that consumer desire to have more, because there's something about it, our brains, we love to be able to get a deal, love to be able to save money, love to have something new. And the only way is through Jesus. And of course, John 3:16, we all know that so well. Let's read it together. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. So obviously the Lord, he is the ultimate giver. He's the one that he laid down his life so that we could have eternal life. And it's only as we accept him into our lives that we have any chance of being anything more than takers and be the generous givers that he wants us to be. This past week, we've had a number of experiences that really show me that the joy of giving. Last Sunday, we had the parking lot behind the school and daycare that was just filled with clothes. I don't know how many pieces of clothing we had out there, but it was a lot of clothes. And we ended up having a lot of volunteers to help out, but we had over 600 people that came out and to go and take those clothes away. And so we were trying to do the math. I don't know if we were, I mean, some of you mathematicians could probably figure this out. How many, 600 people, not everyone got two bags, but certainly many of them got two bags of clothes. And then you think about how many clothes they can cram into those bags and how many clothes, total clothes, and how much the value of all that clothing. Well, it's kind of staggering when you think about what was given. And so that was a good thing. I don't know, on Thursday, did you notice that we had some, I don't know where you live, but we had some rather wild weather. Did you have any wild weather on Thursday evening? It was almost like whiteout conditions and more. I mean, it was like, could hardly even look out the window. It was so much rain and wind and everything. It was just pelting against the house. Well, I know that Trina Jamaica, she sent me these pictures, and I don't know that she wanted that necessarily have them up on the screen, but she had some limbs down in her yard. And you can see in this tree, that's a pretty big limb that came down. And so she was texting me, and she says, you know, she was a little concerned because of things that she's been having to deal with this week. And yet, the next day, we ended up having had some of our members. I know Jim Simmons, Neil Putterbaugh, Bill Strong had gone over, teamed up with her kids, and in cleaning things up, they ended up getting it all loaded. I can see Kaylin was even jumping on the load there to go and get it all down, but they were able to haul that all off. And that was really an act of giving, you know, as far as helping out in that way. So I think about what Jesus said here about giving. In Luke chapter 6, verse 38, he says, "Give and it will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you." So I just want to encourage you to think about and pray about your giving. Today, obviously, our giving is for the local church budget, which ends up doing a lot of great ministries and touching people's lives, not only here in the church and the community, but also next door at Edelman. And so as you end up returning the tithe that belongs to God and you end up going and giving of your free will love gifts, just ask, Lord, help me to be a better giver. So let's, I invite the deacons to stand as we pray. Father, you've given so much to us. We take it all for granted of just what it meant to break up the heavenly family, to go through the first divorce, as it were, in heaven, so that we could be able to have eternal life. And so I just pray that you'll be with us, Lord. Help us to be learn to be more givers, to trust more in you and your provisions for us, that we'll be generous in giving to you and to others. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, very good. Again, we just want to welcome you, those of you who are watching online, and those of you who have been able to join us here today for worship. I was blessed already. Have you been blessed just with the music and leading into God's presence? Today, we just want to mention that we have a first additional ministry leader, a first reading for our church renovation committee chair, Ernie Bauman III, has graciously felt like that's something that he would like to take on, and I just say praise God for that. And so we're actually got some news this week that I think gave me a little excitement, you know, as we received a updated conceptual drawing. So we'll hopefully be able to have some news here in coming months about what we're proposing to do with renovating the church sanctuary and the lobby, and I think you'll be excited about that. So we'll vote Ernie in officially next Sabbath. Also, just wanted to invite you, hope that you can stay by for our fellowship dinner, our potluck over in the Stutler Center gym. It'll be an opportunity to be able to go and fellowship together, make some new friends, enjoy some good food. So I hope that you can be with us for that. Also, wanted to mention, how many of you have gotten signed up on the Instant Church Directory? Can I see your hands? Okay, the rest of you, you need to get with it. So go to your app store, download the Instant Church Directory app so that you can get to know people and people can get to know you. And hopefully we can be able to have more participation as we move forward. Right after our potluck dinner today, we're going to have an anointing service up in Colburn Hall. And so I just want to invite our elders to come. Vicki Worthington is asked to be anointed, and hope that you can be able to join us for that service. Also, and I'm just having, there we go, the Chosen is this evening, is that right? Okay, well, I wanted to make sure that we were correct. So all the young adults, we wanted to encourage you to come out for the Chosen and talk to Pastor Benjamin, look in your bulletin, you'll be able to find out where they're going to be meeting this evening. And this will be the last that you'll see of Robin and me for a couple of weeks. We're going to go and do, I call it our annual pilgrimage, where we go and visit her family and my family, and we put on a lot of miles and on our vehicle. So anyway, we'll look forward to be back with you in a few weeks in time for Vacation Bible School. And you're going to have to go and help advance that. We're kind of stuck, I think. There we go. Some of you might be looking for mission trip opportunities, but don't have the money to leave home. It actually started this week and is going through the end of the month. A special Maranatha-focused work bee mission project at Mount Pisgah Academy. Hope that you can be able to join. Again, the information is in your bulletin. And those of you, I've been told by Patricia Davis, there's still a few spots for people, seniors, that would like to go to Lake Lure. It's a beautiful place, and be able to take the boat tour. Again, that information is in your bulletin. And then the end of this month, we have which will be a week from tomorrow, we have a church work bee. We have a lot of work that needs to be done outside. Flower beds that need attention. We need to have men and women with chainsaws to come and do some trimming on trees and bushes and things like that. We're going to be ordering a dumpster to be able to go and put all those unneeded branches and debris in. So we hope that you can come out and help our deacons with that. Caitlin Wally is going to tell us a little bit about what's going on with Vacation Bible School. Can you tell us a little bit about what's going on?
Yes, so I was up here last week and I announced it, and I'm up here again. We are doing the Stellar VBS. This is for ages 5 to 12. I'm seeing lots of little faces out in the church. So please, there's a QR code back there if you'd like to register your 5 to 12-year-olds to come and join us for VBS. We're going to have a lot of fun. I also wanted to announce that we are still looking for some volunteers. So far, I have gotten the stations mainly covered, so like the crafts and the games and the little video thing and the Bible story, all that stuff covered, but I'm still looking for crew leaders, so people to lead the kids around all these stations. And then I'm looking for a couple more people to help with setup and takedown the week before VBS and then that Sunday after VBS. So if you're in town, because I know a lot of people are going out of town, but if you're in town, please consider registering to volunteer. I also need to get t-shirts ordered, so I need your t-shirt size. That is in the volunteer registration. If you scan the QR code, I'll have all that information, and that would be perfect. So thank you for considering, and I think we have a video on the next one. Maybe.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Switching command to internal.
Engines off. Opening main door.
Anyway, so as you saw in that cute little video, we're going to have a lot of fun, and this QR code is the same QR code that's out there, and if you're feeling really called right now, you can go ahead and scan this and sign up. Thank you.
So I want to ask this question. How many of you enjoy VBS? Any of you enjoy VBS? Let's see a show of hands. How many have gotten excited about VBS? Now keep your hands up. Now how many of you are willing to help with VBS? No, seriously, it's, you know, really, I think every year Vacation Bible School is a special opportunity to reach out to the community. It's not just touching young lives, it touches older lives too. So please see Caitlin or Emma. They would be much appreciated to have your help. At this time, we have Auntie Michelle. Is Auntie Michelle? There she is. So kids, come on down, collect the offering this morning. All that helps to go and support our students at Edelman Adventist Christian Academy. I think there might even be some dollar bills floating down from the balcony that you'll need to catch. So please come down and catch those dollar bills, those $5 bills, those $10 bills, and we'll have a good story together this morning. Thank you.
Well, good morning, boys and girls. How is everyone? Doing good? Good? That's fantastic. Now, last month was May. What did some of us celebrate last month for our mothers? Mother's Day, right? And tomorrow is Father's Day. Is anybody planning anything special for their fathers? What kind of stuff? Shout it out. What do you guys want to do for your dad tomorrow? What are you going to do?
I'm going to play with my dad.
You're going to play with your dad? Oh, that's, yeah, no work for dad. Dad should just play and have fun. That's excellent. What else? What are you going to do for your daddy?
I'm going to cook with my daddy.
Oh, that's fantastic. Okay, yeah, a nice day for dads to relax. And maybe we could, yes, last one. Yes, yes. Oh, wait, shh, that sounds like a secret. We don't want him to know. Is he here? Oh, he's not here. Oh, okay.
And she put it on his shelf.
She made a card for him. She's going to sneak it in his room and put it on his shelf. Well, that sounds a lot like our story today. So, this is a true story. So once there was, it was on a summer vacation, and Wayne and Julie, his little sister, they were sitting around the house, and they were like, I'm so bored. And then Julie said, I'm more bored than you. What do we do? And then Wayne said, gee, I wish we could be pirates. You know, that sounds so exciting. And then Julie said, we can't be pirates. We get arrested. And he says, yeah, that's true. But there's got to be something we can do for fun. Let's think. And she said, okay. And they sat there. And they sat there and they thought. And then all of a sudden, Wayne jumped up and he said, I have an idea. She goes, what? What is it? He says, we could make our own company. And she goes, our own company? But we're just kids. What can we do? And he said, it'll be the Surprise Package Company. She says, ooh, that sounds exciting, Wayne. Yeah, yeah, I want to do it too. He says, I'll be the president and you can be my secretary. She said, sure. Well, what do we do in this thing? And he said, well, okay, we give people surprises. And she goes, huh, what kinds of surprises? He goes, no, only good surprises, no pranks. We'll find people who need things done for them, and then we'll make them wonder how they happened. It'll be lots of fun. She said, okay, where do we start? Well, their mom at the time had gone food shopping after lunch. And they looked around the house, and they said, I have an idea where our first drop-off. Well, Mom came home, and she was carrying these heavy bags, right? And then all of a sudden, she went in the kitchen, and she put her bags down on the table, and she went and then sat down and just stared at the kitchen. You see, when she left, the sink had a huge pile of dirty dishes everywhere. There were some left out jars of peanut butter and jelly and whatever else that she said, you know, I've got to run to the store. When I come back, I'll go and clean up. But everything was clean. There wasn't one dish in sight. Even the table was cleared off and it was set for supper. She was so surprised. She called the children. They were playing outside and she says, come in. Do you know anything about this? Did your Aunt Marlene come over and clean the house? And they said, no, Mom, we're not sure how it could have happened. Wow, somebody must have been working really hard, though. So, and then on the table, she saw a note, and it said, with love from the Surprise Package Company. The Surprise Package Company? What could this be? And she said, well, whoever it was doing this nice surprise for me, I'm relieved. Now I don't have any more work to do, and this evening I can sit and relax. And you know, moms, that's like the best gift ever, relaxation. So the next day, Wayne and Julie said, all right, this was fun. We need to do it again. So there was an elderly lady. Her name was Mrs. O'Higgins, and she had been sick for a long time. She lived down the street. She didn't really have any family near her. Nobody ever visited her, and she was always sad and lonely. Well, she had been sick recently and in bed most of the time. They had an idea. Early in the morning, they crept down the street, and they dropped off eggs, because she didn't have a lot of money either. So boy, oh boy, some eggs would really be good for her for breakfast. With the note on the front door. So they rang the doorbell and they ran away. Then Miss O'Higgins had come to the door with her cane and she looked down and she said, "My, I wonder who dropped these off." And she looked and it said, "With love from the Surprise Package Company." Boy, oh boy, did that make her day. The next day, there was a boy, Frank Morley, who was in Wayne's class, and Frank had the flu. He was miserable. He was sick in bed all week long, just laying there, looking out his window. Nobody could visit him because he was sick, and boy, was he bored. He wished that he had something to do. Well, all of a sudden, he saw something from out the window. He just saw a little patch of green grass from his window, and there was a tall brick wall. And he saw a box going over the wall with a string on it being lowered down into the ground. And he said, Mom, come quick. Well, Mom came. She said, "What is it, Frank?" He says, "Somebody dropped a box in our backyard. Can you go see what it is?" Well, Mom delivered the box, and it said to Frank, in it were small packages. And it said, "Open on day one, open on day two, day three, day four." Well, today was Monday, so he opened it up and he found a set of paints and paintbrushes, right? He was so happy. It would give him something to do. And there were surprises in each box. And there he said, "Get well, best wishes from the Surprise Package Company." Well, the following day, they went back to Mrs. O'Higgins with more eggs and flowers that they left. But this time, somebody saw them. They were trying to be secret, right? It was the doctor. It was Dr. Brown. He was there visiting Mrs. O'Higgins, seeing if she felt any better. And then after the children ran away, he read the paper and he said, "Now this is what everybody in town's been talking about." Okay, and Dr. Brown had an idea. So he sent a letter addressed to the Surprise Package Company to Wayne and Julie's address, inviting them and their mom to a lunch at his house. Boy, oh boy, there were all kinds of sandwiches and desserts. It was great, and he gave them each a present. But how did he know? Well, he promised to keep it a secret, and the two of them had a lot of fun that summer, surprising the whole neighborhood. Now, the pastor just read from Luke 6:38 that says, "Give, and it will be given to you," right? So Wayne and Julie, they gave some presents to their friends, right? Like the little boy who was sick, and they gave eggs and flowers. So what did they get back? In this story, they got back a present from Dr. Brown, right? But what else did they get back? How did it make them feel doing all these things for people? How would it make you feel? Does it make you feel good doing good things for others? Yeah. So tomorrow, if you see your fathers or your uncles or your grandfathers, right, and you do nice things for them, even if it's just giving a big hug and telling them you love them and thanking them for everything that they do for you, it'll make you feel good inside too. Because Jesus knows that when we give to others and we do good for others, it makes our hearts happy too. Well, I hope everybody has a wonderful day and a wonderful week, and I will see you again. Bye-bye.
How many of you know the name of the institution just to my left over here? It's a school. What's the name of it? Edelman. How many of you know why it's named Edelman? Yeah, there's a lot of people here. How many were here in this church when it was named Edelman at that time? Now, see, there's not many hands. And I want to tell you a little story this morning in preparation for the music that I want to bring to you. Larry and Carol Edelman were one of the pillars of this church at one time. They sang a song, they were very musical, and they sang a song one day in church that I couldn't forget. I've never seen the music of it, but I looked on the internet this morning and I was able to find the words. And one of the songs I want to play this morning for you is a song, the last song that I remember them singing for this church. Because it was sometime after that as Larry and Carol and two of their children were flying up somewhere towards New England states that they decided to stop at the Dulles Airport. They were flying in and wanting to make a landing. And Larry couldn't see the landing lights. So he radioed to the tower, "Turn the lights up, turn the lights up. I can't see the lights." He could not see the lights and did not realize that he was flying upside down. He pulled back on the stick, gave it full power, and crashed, killing himself and his children. Two of the children were left behind here in Spartanburg, and so Vernon Edelman, the brother, came up, took the children down. And when I was looking up information about Vernon today, I found that he had died. He was 90 years old, February or March of this year, and he passed away. But the song that they sang has stuck in my mind for this last, I don't know, 60 years or so. "I traveled down a lonely road and no one seemed to care. The burden on my weary back had bowed me to despair. I oft complained to Jesus how folks were treating me. And then I heard him say so tenderly, 'My feet were also weary upon the Calvary road. The cross became so heavy I fell beneath the load. Be faithful, weary pilgrim. The morning I can see. Just lift your cross and follow close to me. I work so hard for Jesus, I often boast and say, I've sacrificed a lot of things to walk the narrow way. I gave up fame and fortune. I'm worth a lot to thee.' And then I hear him gently say to me, 'I left the throne of glory and counted it but loss. My hands were nailed in anger upon a cruel cross, and now we'll make the journey with your hand safe in mine. So lift your cross and follow close to me. If just a cup of water I place within your hand, then just a cup of water is all that I demand. If by death to living they can glory see, I'll take my cross and follow close to thee."
Thank you. Thank you, Ray, for that wonderful music and for reading the words to the song. They were powerful. Would you please bow your heads as we open the Word of God this morning? Dearest Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the gifts that have been presented to glorify your name this morning, for the testimonies, for the songs, for the stories. And we just ask that you continue to pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that we may not only hear but listen to your word and hear your voice, your blessed, still small voice, through the Bible this morning. We thank you and ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Nicholas Feuerstein grew up in Gladwin, a small town in Michigan. He and his parents grew up in a trailer until his parents got divorced. And when his parents got divorced, his mother won custody, his father remarried. But it didn't take long for his father to move him because of the abuse he was suffering at the hands of his mother. You see, his mother was addicted to drugs. And so her addiction was so severe that she would end up abusing, either neglecting, emotionally, physically abusing her own child. And so Nicholas moved out and lived with his grandparents, where his mother would later overdose, ending her own life. And so needless to say that as a child, as a young boy, Nicholas had a lot of anger at the world for his circumstance. He had a karaoke machine in his bedroom, and with one microphone, he would point it at the CD that would be pumping out the beat, and on the other microphone, he would be freestyling, and it would be recorded to a tape. And so amidst all of the anger and the struggles that he was going through in his family and personal life, music became a way of him being able to really pour out his heart, to express his anger. It was therapeutic for him. And so he continued doing this growing up. His grandparents were Christian, and I believe it was them who really introduced him to Christ and to the faith. And so he grew up in a Christian family with his grandparents, and he would listen to faith-based music. And he would go on. He became an electrician, but while he was an electrician, he would self-upload videos to YouTube, his original tracks that he would record, that he really were his venting sessions. He would upload them. And in 2014, he signed to Capital Christian Music Group, then the EMI Christian Music Group. And so he got a big break. His music, people noticed him. They liked him. But when he signed up with that group, something felt off to him while he was there. And in an interview, the interviewer comments, he seems reluctant to talk about his break in Christian music. His first two albums after signing a record deal started at number one in the U.S. Christian charts. And Nicholas says, it's not that I didn't want to be with the mainstream label, but that's all I knew. Now, content-wise, his music certainly mentioned the Almighty. He certainly had songs about God, but not all of his songs were that way. And he felt like his outlook didn't match with the other Christian artists on that label. He says, in the Christian world, everyone wants to pretend everything is okay. It feels sometimes, like, the end of songs have to have this great positive ending. I wasn't there. My music didn't fit because I didn't feel that way. Church can sometimes feel like we have to put on an act, right? The tie isn't the only accessory. We're also wearing a smile that doesn't really match how we feel. We get out of the car, enter the church building, pretend we didn't have a big fight with our spouse earlier that morning, a big falling out with our kids, a big disagreement. We pretend like we either didn't get fired or we're not under threat of being fired from our job, or maybe it's been a rough week at school, we've been bullied, and yet I'm supposed to show up at a Sabbath school and just not talk about it. And why? Well, because sometimes church doesn't feel like a place that we can't have a positive ending, where we can't tell a story that doesn't have some neat little bow on it, where we can't truly be vulnerable. So Nicholas Feuerstein, some of you may recognize his name, his artist name is just NF. That, yeah, I see a few people nodding their heads to that, okay. He just didn't feel like his music fit. He writes several songs, he writes a song about his mother, about his emotions when she passes, when she overdoses. And it's one of the lines that just keeps repeating is, how could you leave us? How could you leave us? It talks about, why did you love drugs more than me, your own child? It's not a positive song, but it's a real song about real emotions, a real struggle that he still goes through, even into his late 20s, early 30s. He's still struggling with the pain. Mostly, what he says, what he realized about what separated him from his from other self-defined Christian rappers was his output's intent. He says, I'm not a worship artist. That's not my music's purpose. I don't think I'm a preacher. I want anyone to listen to my music, believing in God or not. He sees himself as someone who is a rapper, who is a Christian, and references Christ in his work. But it's this very posture that has made NF so popular and has given him a loyal fan base among other audiences, because he wants to be real. And he doesn't want to just say, he put a neat bow on it and say everything's okay. He says, no, I'm still struggling, I'm still suffering. This is how I feel, this is what I'm going through, and I don't have the answers. But fans of his feel like when they listen to his music, they don't have to wear their smile. They don't have to go to his concert and pretend like things are okay, wear their suit coat and feel like everything's fine. They can go there and they can express their anger and they feel like the person who's singing to them is listening to them, that others are listening to them. A place where they don't have to be preached at, but listened to. A place where things don't have to be okay, they just have to be real and authentic. Where people feel listened to. Throughout the Bible, we are told in many places the importance of listening to people over preaching at them. Which brings us to our passage this morning, which is found in 1 Samuel chapter 3. 1 Samuel chapter 3. A few things to understand about the book of 1 Samuel. There is no king in Israel at this time. There is no monarchy. They're under a theocracy. So that what that means is God is their king, and God speaks through judges, appointed judges is what they're called, which really act as God's mouthpiece and where he works through to gather the tribes together, but there is no king. And so the purpose of 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel is explaining that transition period from a theocracy, from the time of the judges, to the formal monarchy, which starts with King Saul and then goes to King David. So it is explaining this pivotal transition in the nation of Israel's time as a nation. And so it starts off, we're starting off, where there's still judges, all right? So there aren't any kings yet in Samuel chapter 3. And so chapter 3 is towards the beginning of the book of 1 Samuel. And it starts with the birth of Samuel the prophet. And it talks about this heart-wrenching story of how Elkanah, he's Samuel's father, he has two wives, Peninnah and Hannah. But Hannah can't have children, but Peninnah can. And so Hannah, day in, day out, for years it is shown that she's being really abused by Peninnah about being barren, not being able to have children, so much so that in the Bible, Peninnah is described as being a zarah, an adversary of Hannah's. Not just someone who occasionally flings insult, an adversary, an opponent, an enemy. The same way, similar word you might describe the Philistines or something. It was painful. It was painful for Hannah what she was going through and having to experience at the hands of the other wife. Which Elkanah, it doesn't tell us, he may have married a second wife because Hannah was barren. We don't know. But it tells us of the favor that Elkanah still shows Hannah. But it brings us to Hannah. She goes to the temple and she's just prostrated herself on the temple stairs. This is years and years of abuse and suffering. And she finally lays down on the temple steps and she's praying, crying, and pouring out her spirit to God and saying, God, I can't do this. Please give me a child. I'll dedicate him to you and your service. That your name may be glorified. And she's emptying herself so much, she's not even saying the words. We know this because Eli, the high priest, he's sitting out on the steps and he sees that there's this woman. She's just crying and weeping, and she's just mouthing the words, no sound coming out. He thinks that she's drunk. And so he goes to turn her away, but then she explains her what she's doing there, and then he says, the Lord bless you, go on your way. But the Lord listened to Hannah and the outpouring of her spirit and remembered her plea. And Samuel is born and is dedicated to Eli, the high priest, to serve in the house of the Lord, in his tabernacle. And we're told that Samuel continues to grow in favor with God and with men. And though he was just a child, he was faithful to God and like a son to Eli. And so it says in verse 18, now Samuel was ministering before the Lord as a boy wearing a linen ephod. So he's a priest. He's serving as an initiate. And his mother would make him a little robe and bring it to him from year to year when she would come up with her husband to offer the yearly sacrifice. So we see that clearly, you know, he wasn't abandoned by his mother. She still tries to see him as much as she can, gives him a little outfit each year or two to keep up with the growth spurts. She loves him. And then Eli would bless Elkanah and his wife and say, may the Lord give you children from this woman in place of the one she dedicated to the Lord. And they went to their own home. And sure enough, the Lord visited Hannah and she conceived and gave birth to three sons and two daughters. And the boy Samuel grew before the Lord. So here in this chapter, we see that God is listening to the cries of a barren mother, of a barren wife. God is listening. The Lord listens and he remembers. And Eli does too. But unfortunately, Eli, while he listens to the Lord in some things, he doesn't listen to the Lord in other things. So we have the Lord who listens to the cries of the helpless. But then we have Eli, who is, he does value justice and purity. But when his sons abuse their position of power and end up sleeping with women at the gate, his sons are also priests, they are abusing their position of power. But he doesn't rebuke them. He talks with them, but he doesn't remove them from power. He leaves them there. Probably, who knows why? A father who feels like he can't do that to his own sons. The shame. You can fill in the blanks. But he can't do that. And so in chapter 2, the Lord condemns Eli. Because while he listened to the voice of the Lord, he didn't listen to the voices of the women who were calling out to him for justice. And here we have the Lord listening to Hannah. Eli listens to Hannah, but he doesn't listen to the others that his sons abuse. And so there's just this back and forth between who's listening and who's not listening. And Eli's not listening. And so the Lord pronounces a judgment upon him in the previous chapter. Not just him, but his entire family. Which brings us to chapter 3, where Samuel is now a child at this time. A young boy at this time. He's not a man yet. He's still wearing the clothes that his mother knits for him. And it says in verse 1 of chapter 3, "Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord before Eli. And the word from the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were infrequent." Now remember, this is before a monarchy, before a king. So God was their king. And he was supposed to speak through the judge to his people. And so why were the visions and the word of the Lord, their king, rare in those days? It's because of Eli, the judge, who was not being faithful to his office. Israel was full of preachers, but not a lot of listeners. Eli wasn't listening. And it happened at that time, as Eli was lying down in his place, his eyesight had begun to grow dim, and he could not see well. He was an old man. And the lamp of God had not yet gone out. And Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark was. This is the Ark of the Covenant, which held the Ten Commandments, Moses' staff, the place where God's presence resided with his people. That the Lord called Samuel, and he said, "Here I am." In the middle of the night, if someone started talking to me in the middle of the night, I don't know if I would have said, "Here I am." Probably would have either ignored it. My phone is on silent normally when I go to bed. What happens between 9 p.m. and 5 a.m. is between you and the Lord or the authority. But Samuel says, "Here I am." And in the middle of the night, then he goes to Eli and he says, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went down, went back, and he laid down. In other words, go back to bed. I didn't call you. And the Lord called yet again, "Samuel." So Samuel arose, and he went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he answered, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Again, we see an endearing term, son, here. So we see some of this relationship that Eli has with Samuel. Eli's not upset. I mean, those of you who have kids, you know what it's like. The middle of the night, someone bursts into your room. Comes a point where you don't even get up anymore. you just let them jump on you and hope that, you know, they settle down. You say, "Yes, yes, yes." Anyways, I see some of that going on here with Eli and Samuel. Now, Samuel did not yet know the Lord. This is verse 7, and this is crucial. Now, Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor had the word of the Lord yet been revealed to him. He's so young. Samuel's still just a little guy. He doesn't even probably know how to read fully yet. He can't read the word of the Lord. So Eli is the only one who can direct him to the Lord. He's too young. He doesn't know. So the Lord called Samuel again for the third time. And he arose and went to Eli, and he said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli discerned that the Lord was calling the boy. And Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and it shall be, if he calls you, that you will say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. There are people who do not know God's word or his voice, and they need guidance from the believer. And instead of dismissing Samuel's questions, Eli listened to this child. Could have dismissed him, could have said he's being silly, but he listens. He takes him seriously and he listens and points him to the Lord. Just because a concern is coming from a child does not mean it's not important to listen. So are you the kind of person who is listening to the voices of the children in our community? The Lord is calling them. Are you listening? Or even as Eli, do we listen to someone who is coming to replace us? Realizing perhaps for the first time that God was preparing another to fill his own office as judge, bypassing him with his voice and speaking to Samuel. What was Eli's response? He listened. And he helped transition Samuel into his office. He did his utmost to prepare Samuel for his important post by giving him the best counsel that he had. The Lord is calling. Are you listening? Verse 10 continues, "Then the Lord came and stood and called as at other times." And here we have God, you know, getting up off of the throne, stood. It's important when someone stands. They're making a stand. They're making a statement. God is standing. Called as at other times, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And on the climactic fourth approach to Samuel, the Lord called the boy's name twice and stood. This repetition of the personal name, it is reminiscent of when God gave Moses his call to ministry. It's reminiscent of when he spoke to Abraham and on Mount Moriah, gave his call to his people. So here we're seeing, really, this is a setup. It's the same thing. Just as Moses was set up, just as Abraham was set up for a specific ministry, Samuel is being called as a major prophet at a time of major transition for the nation of Israel. He's being called in a similar way. And this was only possible because Eli listened and helped him to see the Lord. It was an important point in his life. And he urges the Lord to speak because he's listening. And the Lord said to Samuel, "Behold, I am about to do a thing in Israel in which both the ears of everyone who hear it will tingle." Now, throughout these verses, these three verses, there's a verb and it's just blasted in every single verse. And it's Shema. And this word, often it's translated as simply hearing, but there's more to it than that. It's not just about hearing. It means to intelligently listen. In other words, this word, it means, you know, you're not hearing some white noise. You know, it's like you're speaking to me, but you're not actually listening to me. Right? There's a difference. You're hearing the traffic, but you're not paying attention to the traffic. You're hearing your kids. You're not actually paying attention to your kids. Or your coworker, your boss is talking. You're not actually listening to your boss. You're just hearing it. But this word, it means to intelligently listen, to actively listen. That is what Samuel is doing. And God is saying, I'm about to do something that will cause Israel to listen. To listen to my voice. The voice that they haven't heard that often. But they will. Jeremiah 5:21 kind of illustrates this dual meaning that this word has. It says, now hear this, O foolish and senseless people. And this is centuries after, okay? So this isn't the same time period that Jeremiah is writing, but he uses the same word. Who have eyes, oh, now hear this, O foolish and senseless people, who have eyes but do not see, who have ears but do not hear. They do not shema. They're not actually actively listening. And even today, we have different definitions, different terms for different types of listening. We have comprehensive listening. We have defensive listening, biased listening. We have sympathetic listening. But the most valuable type of listening that I would say is the closest to the same type of listening that represents the Hebrew word here would be actively listening. I'm sure as many of you in your studies or in your workplaces or self-help books have heard the term active listening. And that's really, I would compare that to what is being discussed here, intelligently listening to someone. The Lord called to Samuel and he listened. And that's because Samuel was certainly the listening kind. Again, we have this dichotomy where we have in chapter 1, the Lord listens. Chapter 2, Eli doesn't listen. Chapter 3, Samuel listens. There's this compare and contrast going on. But Samuel, I mean, he will listen for the rest of his life to the voice of the Lord. This guy, I mean, he's like Moses when it comes to this. He listens to the word of the Lord even when it was against his own father figure. Because what the Lord has to tell him after this is not a pleasant thing, but Samuel listens anyways. Listens actively, intelligently, not defensively, not reproachfully, actively listening to the Lord. And even though he's as important as Moses and Abraham were, later on when Samuel would literally be replaced. Israel wants a king. They're calling out, we want Saul. Saul's elected, but they want a king like everybody else, even though Samuel's doing an excellent job. Really a spotless job. You don't really see a lot of mistakes that he makes. But Samuel listens to the voice of the Lord and he listens to his fellow people. Even if they're wrong, he listens. Just as Eli did for him, he ensures that the transition is smooth. And without a fuss, he passes the baton to Saul. I have to ask today, are there any Samuels still listening to the voice of the Lord? Now, Samuel's call to ministry teaches us many things. Teaches us about God's anger towards those in leadership who use their position to abuse other people and the consequences of leaving them in leadership. It talks about the importance of mentorship and not getting defensive and passing the torch. It talks about the ministry and how it's not so much preaching as it is about listening. And it's that third point that I'd like to focus on today. Are you intelligently listening, not just to the word of the Lord, but to other people as well? James 1:19 says, this you know, my beloved brethren, but everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. How oftentimes is that reversed? I must be quick to anger, quick to speak, and slow to listen. That's not what it says. That's not what Samuel does. That's not even what Eli does. Slow to speak, slow to anger, quick to listen. In what way is the Lord calling you to listen this morning? In what aspect of your life? Is it to a young person who you have noticed going through a hard time? For whatever reason, you've noticed they're down. Are you listening? Are you willing to listen to them? Is it a family member who's been out of sorts? Someone you know is going through something, but, you know, it's just kind of awkward to talk about, so we don't talk about it. But are you willing to listen to them about what they're going through? Is it to a fellow church member who has also been acting reserved? Ever since this thing happened, they just seem so quiet. Have you asked? Have you made yourself available for them to listen to you? Perhaps it's a coworker or someone you see regularly at work, or even someone who's being set up to take your replacement. Are you listening to them? They could be stressed. Could be a lot of work. You could be retiring. You could be transitioning. You could have been fired. Who knows? But are you listening to them? Are you concerned for their needs? Are you intelligently listening to those around you? Because the reality is that before we're able to listen to the voice of the Lord, we have to be able to listen to each other. If you can't listen to what is above you, how can you listen to, or if you can't listen to what is in front of you, beside you, how can you ever hope to listen to what's above you? If you can't endure a conversation where you have to speak and get angry, how can you listen to the voice of God without getting defensive, without letting down your guard? See, Jesus was notorious for his active listening in his ministry. We like to think that Jesus went around preaching, and that's all he did, but that's not what all he did. In fact, a lot of his preaching appointments were interrupted because he had to take the time to listen. We have the Samaritan woman, the woman at the well, the woman who was bleeding, the children who would run up to him, and everyone would say, "You don't have time for that," but he said, "Yes, I have time to listen. I have time to listen to these people." The paralytic let down through his roof, where he literally stops his sermon, his exposition, and he listens to their needs. Nicodemus, he listens to him, and the list goes on and on and on. God is calling us to listen. Are you listening? Ministry is not so much about preaching as it is listening to those around us, and especially to the voice of the Lord. And so the question comes up, what can we do to listen better? And there's a lot of resources out there. You can simply ask about moments of change. How did that make you feel when this happened? What happened next? What led up to that? Ask open-ended questions. See, sometimes we're so focused on having the right answers, we don't really listen to people. As soon as someone starts talking, we start thinking of a response in our head. But that's not really listening to them. You see, even if you have the right answer, not everyone's looking for the right answer. And some things in life don't have a right answer. There is no answer at a tragic funeral. There is no answer for Nicholas Feuerstein's mother who overdoses and he's left alone after being abused. There's no answer you can say at a funeral that will fix the situation. But you can listen. Listening is always the right answer. Hearing more from them, their perspective, asking it free of judgment, free of your opinion, free of your advice, just listening, and being responsive. The time when they can say, we've talked about me for an hour. What about you? I'm tired of talking to myself. It's often quoted how lonely people feel in our modern era. Why? Nobody's listening. There are people who are into their 80s, their 90s, and if you were to ask them, has anyone ever taken an hour and just sat down with you and listened to you? Has that ever happened? A lot of people will say, no. No one's ever taken the time to listen to me. No one's taken the time to listen. Not as Samuel listened, and not as the Lord listened to Hannah. The point of listening is to understand and not to respond. You want to understand where the other person is coming from. You want to understand their feelings. You want to know them, intimately know them, to listen. It's not your answers that will prevent hardship, a suicide, or another catastrophe, but your ability to listen. Usually people just need to felt heard, to know that there's somebody out there that I can talk to who won't judge me for how I feel, for my wrong mistakes. They'll just listen to me. Because we love people. They feel love when they're listened to. And so the world is yearning for people. The world is full of people yearning to be heard, listened to, and understood. And the Lord is calling us, is calling you to this task of listening. But are you listening to the voice of others and to the voice of the Lord? Maxie Jones started her second semester of 10th grade on February 1st, 1978. And on February 2nd, she woke up to go to school, but her mother did not wake up that morning. Her mother passed. And after that, it was very difficult for Maxie to do her schoolwork. Because it was her mother who was the one who encouraged her to go to school. She didn't have any interest in it. She didn't care about her studies, but she did it because of her mother. But now her mother was gone, and there was no one in her life to support her, to listen to her, to encourage her to pursue her education. And so she struggled. And so in school, her mind would often wander elsewhere. It would get fixated on other things, and when the teachers would ask her a question, she'd have to ask, what was the question again? I didn't hear it. I'm sorry. And if 9 times out of 10, if they restated the question to her, she would be able to answer it correctly. And so it wasn't that she was completely shirking her responsibility or that she wasn't intelligent or anything like that. It's just she wasn't paying attention. And why? Because her mother wasn't there to encourage her anymore. Well, one teacher, on one particular day, in his particular 10th grade class, paid attention. And so he asked her to stay after class one day. And he asked at this pivotal meeting, Mr. Goldberg mentioned his observations and asked Maxie what was going on. And after that, he listened to her. He listened to what was going on in her life. Didn't tell her, you need to study harder, you need to be this way, you need to shape up. Said, what's going on, Maxie? I've noticed this. You want to share with me what's been going on in your life? I want to understand. And that made all the difference. And after sharing her story and her struggles and her pain, Goldberg then asked that Maxie meet with him the next day after class. Or not after class, but during his prep period, sixth period, the next day, where she would be given another opportunity to talk. And so sure enough, Maxie met with them just to talk. And so time went on and on, and it, you know, she would talk, but he'd also have her help grade some papers or things, help him prep for his classes. But really, this was a chance for her to be able to share what was on her heart and just talk. Just talk to him, and he would listen. And this went on every single day. He had her meet with him during his prep period, and they would talk. And when open school night came, this is now Maxie speaking, I went with my sister, who had just graduated from the same school, because I had no one else to go with. My social studies teacher wouldn't talk to her because he thought it was some kind of trick. And Mr. Goldberg happened to be outside the room, so he came in and said, "Wait a minute, talk to her, I'll explain later." So he didn't only listen to her, but he helped other teachers to listen about what was going on in her life. And he went around to all of her classes and explained, "Hey, it's not that she doesn't care about learning. It's not that she's just going through something right now. Just be patient. Don't get offended. It's okay. Just listen to her. Come to me if you have problems." And he could do that because he took the time to listen and understand where she was coming from. And the next year, he did the same thing. Every single day, talked to all the teachers, stood up for her, listened to her. And by the time that Maxie had graduated from high school, she hadn't missed a single day of school. Not a single day. And at her graduation, Mr. Goldberg told her, "This feels funny. I teach 10th graders, not seniors, so I never come to the graduation." And so she asked, "Well, why are you here?" And he replied, "Because I wouldn't miss seeing you graduate for anything in the world." For anything in the world. And reflecting on this event, Maxie says, "It took me years before I realized what he had done. I graduated from high school in the top 15% of my class. I had a Regent scholarship and a full ride to college. The truth is, I was always academically capable of that. But at 15, having lost my mother and not really seeing the value of education, I was in line to be a statistic, a high school dropout. I realized that the reason I showed up to school every single day was because somebody there was expecting to see me. And that somebody was Mr. Goldberg." Maxie's story highlights the impact listening can make in a person's life. And like Nicholas Feuerstein highlights, is this church, Spartanburg Church, a place where things don't have to have a bow tie on it, where things don't always have to have a positive ending? But that's okay, because we're not here to preach, we're here to listen. We're here to listen as God listens. Because after all, it's only after listening to others that you really can preach to a message. Is this a place where being authentic is more important than wearing a fake smile? The Lord is calling. Are you listening? Is there someone in here today that you've thought about talking with, listening to? You know they've been going through hard times. Are you feeling called today to listen to them? Perhaps you have been struggling with dark thoughts. There's been things going on in your life. Is there someone that the Lord is calling you today to talk to? Sometimes we're in a position to listen. Other times, we need to be in a position to be listened to. Is there someone here today you can share in that relationship with? Are you feeling called to start a connect group dedicated to learning how to listen and listening to each other? The possibilities are endless. Whatever your context is, the Lord is calling you today to listen. So, are you listening? Are there any Samuels out there? Then the Lord came and stood and called as at other times, "Samuel, Samuel, Spartanburg, Spartanburg." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening.
Can you stand with us and sing? We're going to sing Hosanna.
I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes. The whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sins. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna,
take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. On our knees, on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Dearest Heavenly Father, we thank you first for listening to people like Hannah, people who are on their knees, at their wit's end, after years of suffering, people who others would walk by, would ridicule, but you listen, and not only listen, but you answer their prayers. You listen to people like us. People who, though we try to pretend that everything's okay, have a lot that we're going through. And so, Father, as you listen, as Jesus listens, we ask that you help us to model that behavior, to listen to each other, that the next time we notice someone is going through something, we make ourselves available to listen to them and their story, to understand. The next time that we are struggling with someone, whether that someone be a replacement, as Samuel was to Eli, or as Saul was to Samuel, that we have the patience and the understanding to listen to them. That you give us the ability to listen to our young people. That we acknowledge and realize their concerns are authentic and real. And we point them to you. That the next time we have a disagreement, we listen to each other. That we are slow to speak and even slower to anger. Father, not for our glory, but that you may be glorified, that your love may reign supreme, that this church may be a place that resembles your kingdom, something that is to come. Give us a listening heart, Father, that we may be the listening kind. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.